from China. So in this figure, it shows you the transaction across 157 cell types. So each bar is a tissue cell type. And the value is the transfer protein cells. Also, imagine all the data actually are processed through the same pipeline. And obviously, shortly, not all the data actually are gathered by some serious lab and the reference lab on this particular table we can talk later today. Okay? So the tissues are actually organized according to their situation. It's a mandatory curriculum by my students. And if you go further down to this website, for this picture, actually, you can tell me you're using for computations. So you can click here. See if it's JPEG or TNG. See, it's working. Great. Pretty good. So if you use it for computations, you're not using many rows. You really don't need that many bars. So that's why my students have a very smart function. So if you go further down, you can choose what you want to display in the query. Okay. You can choose a big category. You can look for all the RAs or only the EPs RAs. You can use the full RAs or tommy flat RAs. Here is where you can select all the features or select all the features. Right. So something we know is a gene high stress cell and some other protein cells. So let's go further down and search ESL. Or I think it's feature set. Stem cell. Choose 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Choose one of the 6 data sets. Go back to the top. Here and update graph. Okay. Click this update. Now we're plotting the expression for these 6 cell types. Right. You put the amount over the bar and it shows you the value. So these values are all normalized. So you gotta use it for comparisons. So follow the system, so follow the good and follow the instructions. See the back.
Code grounds, both sides to create a subgroup, the core, the core of RNA regulation. And there's But there are any barcodes that we use some pieces for cooling, that's already been done.
steps, using basically shifted versions of the adapters. We also have adapters by default. It's very good at dealing with five-prime truncations. If you're looking for basically double adapters. So I'm happy to talk about today in more detail. I'm talking about offline, but just be careful with the downstream because it can be a problem. So the next step is repetitive element removal. The key aspect here is that even for a really good clip data set, still probably 10 to 20% of the reads are going to be RUX-OMRNA, and then you expect to get higher. And in an ideal world, those are just massive RUX-OMRNA transcripts, and you've been done with them. In reality, they want to map into pseudogenes all over the place and create really good test positive signal scan. So to alleviate this for general processing, we first map to rep base, remove all those reads that map to rep base, and only take the remaining ones and take those for signal mapping. We have some repetitive element specific analysis tools that I'll talk about later. They're most interested, but for general processing, that's what we do. We try to get rid of repetitive elements to avoid artifacts. Then we do standard pairing mapping with STAR, same way we map to the RNA map to the genome, to the transcriptome, to the genome, plus response to the database, as we get the map reads. So then, for feature removal, if you're familiar with CHIP or RNA-seq, which is used to STAR to stop the distance of mapping, because we have the randomers, we can actually do better than that, and so we take reads that map to the same location, and have the same randomer sequence, and we discard those, anything more than one, that has the same randomer sequence to start. And so the pair, the BAM file that is on CC, is the output of this feature duplicate removal that only contains uniquely mapped, non-repetitive, non-PCR duplicate reads. So here's an example of what that looks like for an average data set. So for some of the older clip methods, you can see that, at one time, you're going to get some reads that are too short to do anything with FQC sequence on there to get started. We usually see on the order of 10-20% mapping to repetitive elements, so maybe 10% doesn't need to match the genome. But the real advantage of our improved CCLIP methodology is that the number of PCR duplicates that we have to see is very low, whereas a lot of older clip protocols, you just have an enormous level of PCR duplication. So across, now just going across about 300 enclosed clip experiments, you can see the fraction of usable reads, basically this green over this green and this gray. Most of the time, the we're now in 80-90% mean, whereas most published clip data sets are now about 5-10% not PCR duplicates. Okay, so, again, very quickly, the BAM files on CC, the standard BAM files, except again, that randomer is still on the retain, just in case you want to use it for something. Okay, so, CHIP called Keeps. This is something that's still a little bit of work in progress. You can actually take our data and call use it for, like, many standard CHIP CC colors. They have to be strand aware, so it messes up a little bit, but the way that we actually call Keeps usually is you use a key calling algorithm called Clipper, that was developed in our lab a few years ago. The idea is it identifies regions that are significantly enriched above the transcript that it's in, so even if the transcript is varied by orders of thousandfold expression, so we're looking for regions that show higher binding than the average level of that transcript. So Clipper does that. We then take the Clipper output and then compare those against that paired-sized matching clip. Very simply, we just literally just take that key called Keep region, get a number of reads in clip, get a number of reads in input, do a very simple enrichment test to determine the enrichment of the clip. So this is not usually done in clip, but for CHIP, I mean, you guys are all very familiar with this important. For clip, we saw that it was really, again, enormously important. So even if we saw something like FLT, which is exclusively binding system RNA, something very well studied, very well characterized, we actually see basically RNA sequencing coverage at above the cheats, so this is EF2. The input and FLT clip will have the same. But CHIP RNA sequencing actually does show a little bit of binding on these SRs. So it's not that everyone looks exactly the same, it's just that you always get some level of background. But if you take the FLT clip and now actually plot the read density in input versus the full enrichment in clip, you can see the differences are all very clearly enriched. So there isn't just a flat, level of all backgrounds in every clip experiment, you can really just normalize away different regions that are enriched in other relative to input. So for these specific two examples, one example of a region that's actually not enriched, so B12 small RNA, shows up as a fairly common artifact in almost every clip data set. It has a lot of reads, so reads a million and 500, that's a lot of reads, but if you actually compare to the input, it's actually depleted in this clip. Whereas the trick command of the 6 RNA is something like 2 to the 9th enriched. So it is actually very clean, you just have to do proper normalization to get rid of those false positives. So the key thing to note then is if you download the RNA clip files from the CC, these are input normalized peaks, but actually contain every clipper called peak, including the ones that are not enriched, and even including ones that are depleted in the clip relative to the input. So if it's a good file, it has the region, it has the information, but then it has the column zero of log 2 full enrichment and minus 1 10 p-value. And so if these ones all have to be enriched, if you go down the sort of list, you'll get ones that are actually the full enrichment is negative. And so we provide those to people, we provide those all for analysis purposes. In some cases, for example, for IDR, they're actually very useful because you need not enriched peaks to run something on IDR. We also provide it so that people can set their own cutoffs and their own trade-offs and specificity versus specificity, but it's going to be that up to you. We standardly use 10 to 5th and basically default enrichment as sort of a stringent criteria. It seems to work pretty well at removing false positives. There are definitely real signals below that, but it works pretty well for us in getting a good high-quality set of peaks, usually on order of 100,000 for our team, that doesn't have very many false positives. Okay, so then very quickly, just going to get a couple of highlights of what we can do now, the kind of analyses that people can think about using CD4. So we have, the most simple ones, individual RBT analyses. So for individual RBT, which is an example here again with FOX2, you can ask questions like, what are the motifs that are enriched? At all binding sites, or only at binding sites, in neutrons, proximal neutrons, different CRs, we can ask, where are the peaks for this RBT? This case, FOX2 is very heavily enriched in proximal distant neutrons, relative to mRNA, which is another background. We can even ask things like, where along the pre-mRNA or mRNAs of this RBT bound? In this case, it has a little bit of a 5' distribution, so you can see it right here on pre-mRNA, exons and flat, neutrons tend to be very enriched near the 5' plus rate. So we can ask these very simple questions. And then, in addition to the clip, we can start to look at other resources. So we integrate this with RBT localization, and this is from our Bluecase lab. And you can see the FOX2 in their data is basically, there's a little bit of positive, but really heavily nuclear, and actually exclusively opposite of the nuclear signal. We can also integrate that with RNA-seq data to create these so-called RBT maps, splicing maps, where the idea here is to say, okay, if we look at exons that are inversely regulated by FOX2, where does FOX2 bind near them? So in this case, in blue, exons are included upon FOX2 knockdown, tend to have more FOX2 binding here, whereas RBT, skipped exons that are excluded upon RBT FOX2 knockdown, you get an enrichment binding, for example, here. So people, these splicing maps are also different maps for each.
Thank you.
the interface of a phase tool, which provides a very simple interface for retrieving specific regulatory data. And so once you have a genome position or region that you know that you want to know more about, you can use a web interface on ProTrue on the website itself. And you can input into the database and it outputs all the down regulatory factors and additional information from the input project. And so we're going to be in the bunch of different data types, and they're all listed in the columns of the table here. You know, they have all the QTLs in there, have sensors and factor binding data, mostly sensor data, that has matched sensors and factor motifs in data, so it looks through various motifs and data sets, and also there's the next line. And it has DNA splitting data in there, has DNA geek, et cetera. And so we're going to develop the scoring system for ULDB, where different combinations of it, there was evidence, contributed in the score, and generally, if you have a lower score, there's more evidence that that region or that size is, that's some regulatory factors present. And so there's a lot of data in this database, and this is our most recent update. And so you can just go through this list, but there's many different conditions and cell lines from ENCODE and also from non-ENCODE, many different data types. So it's really supposed to be a summary of all of ENCODE in this database. And now I want to show you a quick example of how to use it. And you can pull this up. So here's the website. Here you can see it. Okay, so it's regulome.stanford.edu. Here's the main page. You come here and there's some examples. If you click, so this is where you put what region of the genome you want to interrogate in there. You want to separate it so you can put a bunch of them in at the same time. And so each of these little hyperlinks is give you an example. So you can put a different, you can search different ways. You can use these FIDs, these RFIDs. You can use zero base coordinates. You can actually use a file, a VCF file, and or a GFF file. And so it has all these examples here so you can make sure you get the file format right. And so you can choose one of these or your own. You can edit it to this. It doesn't work as a slice on it, but it should work because it just did. Okay, let's try to do this. That's frustrating. Anyway, that would have been better, but we can just go through this one. So after you hit submit, you'll come to a page that looks like this. And it'll be for every one of the coordinates or RFID that you enter, you'll have a different row. And it'll tell you the coordinates you put in, the DBFID, and then it gives you the score that you started a minute ago. And it'll link down to UCSD Ensemble if you want to see a view of the genome browser. And as you click on one of these guys, you can go down to it, for example. You would then come to a new page that has a bunch of that has all the data laid out individually. And so here's to the genome browser view. I think if you put this thing, it also links to the genome browser. And as you scroll down, I'm going to click on this slide. You see, first you see protein binding data. So for this is for one particular site, it'll show you all the different experiments where there was overlap of these different shift sheets. So in this particular experiment, that you would read up like where they're doing full RFUA shift sheets, there's overlap of a peak. And then it also links out to the reference of the actual data that was used to call this. And then so it has this protein binding data, it has protein data, so this is a transcript adjuster, et cetera. And so it's motifs plus the description of where that came from. So there's also these different methods that were used. There's the footprinting, et cetera. And there's also carbon structure data, so this would be things like DNA seq. And there's different motifs data, and et cetera, et cetera. So all those, I should show you a slide a minute ago, all the different data types, they're all here in table format. And then, let's see, I should also mention, to go back here, to the summary slide. So this is the sort of, yeah. When you have all your coordinates you want to enter, you can submit, you get to this page like this. You can download, you can actually download the full output. So say you have 10,000 of these things you want to interrogate at the same time. You can download, and then you can get a file that looks just like this guy. And so basically it has all that data in a text file, so you can parse it on your own, if there's some content. And that's actually very helpful. And if you have more than maybe 10,000 or so, in addition to having, it looks like a break in a certain number, but you need to the browser to develop it. So if that happens, we have an API, we have a little program to constrict. Scripted off of ULDB, and that's hosted on Alex's GitHub page, and so you can see it here. And with that, if you have any questions, my email address is email@stanford.edu, so any user has a question you have, I'm happy to answer any questions about how it's built or the data that are in there. You should ask Alex, and then you can email address here. I'm also a user of the Hubbard SRD symbol, and with the testing of the content flow, the ENCODE data that is mining is the London and so on. Do you have any plans to be more updated? So, yeah, Alan does have plans. I don't know if I can take a few myself, but he did update it, I know, not this last fall, but fall before, but he updated it last year as well, so he is updating it. And he did wrote a grant to continue working on it, and he's updated, so probably regardless of whether he gets funded, he'll continue, but you should ask him.
Thank you. And second question, this is what I mentioned right now, I'm not reminding ways, the same searches, and the one that I think there's more use on
those sites. It's just the first one. So, yeah, it basically mimics being new and going in, and it'll come to the file of maybe a million or 10,000 of different new lines of limited searches you want to do, and it'll put them in maybe, I don't remember how I did it, maybe it was 1,000 or so at a time, maybe 100, whatever, didn't fall down the website too much. It'll just go through them one at a time and get the output, download the full output, like I was showing you here, and it'll just do that repetitively, just one after another. And if that script on there doesn't do it,
So you can say, okay, well, now we can't explain what this thing does or what the light comes from this thing might be. So we just move on to our next thing. Basically, what Hepplerick does, and this is going to show you the growth space of the M1 space right here. But what Hepplerick does is it looks at what the LV structure, so what's this, what's the image this, around the Leo taxon, are very strong LV with your Leo taxon, right? And it is that the LV structure is strong enough, that the correlation is strong enough, that you can also look at the other spins, you can theoretically look at others. So even though our lead stick is not inside of our answer region, we now have a bunch of candidates here we can also look at, if we zoom in this city, have a block. We can also look at whether these things are making interesting regions. As you can see in this case, you know, these do apply in an answer region to a specific or GM1 space, right? This is just a cartoon example. Now we actually look at a real example, it's not that different. Maybe a cartoon example, it's a radical example, maybe. So now we see again, our lead stick, and defaults actually inside an answer region specific for GM1 space, okay? But maybe we don't have any further evidence of what's going on. Maybe we look at the underlying sequence, so we take this stick and we look at regular MDD, there's little evidence of right? So that's basically where it essentially starts with regular MDD. For Hepplerick, you can now say, okay, let's actually look at the other SNPs that aren't in the same LD block, see whether there's anything underlying those SNPs that might actually give us clues onto what that region might be doing. If you look at that one, in particular, the SNP that's a strong LD from the first SNP, it actually turns out that if you look at the sequence, at the particular SNP right here, you can actually see that it actually strengthens the binding motif for ETS1, which is actually a bit better with less linear patterns. Moreover, it turns out that if you look into other areas found in the particular SNP study, a lot of those actually also affect the ETS1 locus. So by exploiting the LD structure, you basically get a second chance at finding a potential regular mechanism. So this is really the sort of the main difference between GM1 and and more recently, there's been another update, with, you know, like an update of Lego data, update a little bit of Robocop's data, more mostly data is in there, this leads to the GTL studies, etc. So this is what this is. Again, all these slides are available, so if you want. One very useful thing to point out is that if you look at this latest bar paper, it actually contains a very short, sweet tutorial that takes you step by step through the process of using Hepplerick for a particular study there. So what does this look like? This is a...
So Right. just changing the focus a little bit. So I come from an office.
Zev, and what Zev has focused a lot of time on synergies, and his life, and I probably agree with his synergies, but it's significant with Vegeta. And for profit of synergies, they inherit both. They have they obviously have a condition of homologous to a functional element, and the sort of default function, the default position a lot of people have, is that synergies have no function. However, using exosome, so just as a reminder, for those of you who are quite familiar, the human that doesn't technically create synergies, either by sort of genome duplication, or if you have categorized RNA that is retrotransposed and sort of inserted back into the genome, and it acquires sort of a variety of different mutations, such as privileges, loss, friendships, and so on, in order to use the same gene. So this, the synergy core function, and in the same as the parent gene, because it's the natural protein coding, the potential of the synergy that's being described. So, the lab has sort of been involved in annotating synergy into the genome. So we've got our pipeline doing this, and as part of the JPEG project, we've been collaborating with Brain Vitals in Santa Cruz, and Atlanta is a center, to combine the annotation output from the three different pipelines in order to get the consensus of synergies, that is, basically, the consensus of synergies in this part of JPEG. And what we've been going to show you is we've annotated these synergies by combining with thousands of genomes data, but more importantly, encode data to see what we say about whether these synergies are really dead. And what you see is some people have reported synergies being transcribed for a while now, but a lot of people were quite skeptical of that, because So people have reported that synergies are transcribed, but people were quite skeptical of them, saying, well, it's just a transcription for positive, transcription for the heresy, the heresy is transcribed, and you're just getting sort of sequence reads, or the perspective back into the synergy. But this example, when you have lots of data, this example study work, is you can see that if you look at the transcription of the synergy, the heresy in a variety of different species or spaces, you find it's not correlated. So this quantity is a direct correlation of the heresy being transcribed, and reads understanding. I mean, this is, I know it's not correlated. And when you do the function about, you can find that, conceptually, this is you know, probably more than 1,000 human synergies being actively transcribed. And we've done experimental validation, you see, using quantity PCR, or using quantity specific quantity PCR to prove that these things are actually transcribed. And this is the last slide, just want to emphasize. So what we did, using encode and non-body encode data, and not just the transcriptional data, is we took all our synergies in human, worm, and fly, and we layered on all the transcribed data. So you can sort of differentiate those that are transcribed, those that have active arrays, those that have active chromosomes, such as the equity standard generation, and those that have transcriptional macrobytes. And what we find is the result is there's a small number of synergies for each of the organisms, where you see all these things occurring. But there's a whole sort of spectrum of stuff in the middle, where they sort of possibly active, where maybe you don't see the arrays, you see transcription, you see a sort of so the consequences of this is that there's a lot of synergies that are potentially have some sort of advanced functional in terms of the original protein gene role, but potentially acquire something functional. This is one form of transcription. And this is some examples. And then in the literature, there's some 9 examples of specific cases of transcribed synergies that are known to acquire new functions, such as endogenous sRNAs, microRNA decoys, and so on. So just to summarize, I'm going to go into this detail. So the history of basic transcription, our results demonstrating that basic transcription is in fact and is actually conserved across all of these three models, really human, and that transcribed synergies are very well characterized, and there's lots of evidence that there's many synergies have a lot of biological activity, and it has some interesting potential roles. And just for the last slide, just to emphasize that this was done as a big project in 2014, and it was led largely by Mark Lucy, with the number of members of Mark's lab, and the data was progressively from Brenton to Tom and Fabot, and Christina and Mike led the synergy effort, which I reported on there. So that's it.
Many of these common diseases trials are in which individual services of human genome and in both Roswell and GCAP projects have found that after the intervention and non-coding practice are also and also successfully performed using human cancer lines and or normal cells from the non-brain tissue. You might contact emerging on the human brain. The brain has several cells, but many of them are still not understood. And characterizing brain genome, the challenging not only about the brain diversity, not only communication, gene regulation, and chromatin receptor cuisine, but also about brain presence heterogeneity, which may bias the self-aesthetic epigenetic patterns, influencing defining in psychiatric epigenetic disease. And therefore, it's really important to construct and get the neural epigenome from the brain, which will complement existing mechanical approaches on what should help the genes to deeper understand the alternate identity and functional differences, as well as providing a possible link between brain development and diseases. And the focus of my slide today is the one part of the critical mark, social shape for gene regulation, which is well established for mostly. And previously, our lab showed people shape for gene regulation operation in the algebra before campaign, and we observed dynamic gene regulation and this is what I consequence of studying 4,000 of individuals find the genes encoding protein involving the genetic function, and most importantly, chromosome regulation. And on the effects of the psychiatric genetics concern to show that the decolonized regulation is emerging as a central center in the brain development and function. And if you see in this slide, many of the genes for the chromosome regulation are linked to some of the developmental disorders, like such as schizophrenia and epilepsy with stable gene. And I'm investigating roles of chromosome gene regulation domain in the prefrontal cortex by performing genome wide mapping of chromosome gene regulation in neural and non-neural nuclei from the control and fixed control campaign. Our hypothesis is that the genetic regulation is not coding treatment.
Thank you. So we can unambiguously know who the first publisher is, so we like, and we also support the data process. So Hearing a lot about why the people have worked very hard to create this, I want to thank them.